Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. Today's event, Indigenizing Institutions, features a conversation with our guest speaker, Taylor Payer, and is co-sponsored by the Gallery and Museum Studies Program in the Art and Design Department at Queensborough Community College. The Kupferberg Holocaust Center in Bayside, New York, is situated on the traditional land of the Manitinacock people who live here today. We continue to offer gratitude and respect to all of the Indigenous people of Turtle Island, past, present, and future, including the Lenape and Shinnecock peoples. What I just read is what we call a land acknowledgement. This is a statement recognizing that the land we all occupy in the course of our daily lives, including our schools, jobs, parks, and homes, as well as the names of towns and roads, was first inhabited by another group of people who were forcibly expelled and murdered. Today, we identify those crimes for what they are: mass atrocities and genocide. These horrors continue to have devastating political, social, psychological, and economic impacts upon and within Native American and Indigenous communities. Today's event is the second in our Human Rights and Museum series, a powerful new collaboration with QCC's Museum and Gallery Studies program. This series builds upon the KHC's longstanding tradition of connecting core themes within both Holocaust and human rights education, of erasure and tragedy, of visibility and resilience, with how they are expressed and taught within museums and education centers. After the presentation, please be sure to submit your questions via the Q&A feature on your screen. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Amadis Matos, who is the Executive Advisor to the President for Equity and Diversity at Queensborough Community College. Prior to joining QCC, she was the Director of Academic Affairs at Hostos Community College. At Hostos, she identified and addressed issues of access and equity in registration and enrollment processes and introduced practices that address the needs of marginalized populations. Amadis, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Laura. Thank you for inviting me to take part in today's conversation. I am thrilled and honored to participate. Today's conversation on Indigenizing institutions is a very timely discussion for Queensborough. The college is in the final stages of developing a strategic plan focused on equity. A large part of the campus's work on equity will be reflective as we delve deep into inquiry and start to address questions such as whose stories are being told, whose history is being centered, and how are we interacting with one another as a community? As we embark upon this work, it is vital that we harness the rich cultural capital present in our beautifully diverse community and allow the wisdom that is present to inform not just the work that we do, but who we are. So thank you to the organizers for creating this forum, and thank you all for showing up today to participate.
Thank you so much, Amadis. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce my colleague and partner on this series, Kat Griefen. She's the program coordinator for the Gallery and Museum Studies program at QCC and a faculty member of Museum Studies at CUNY School of Professional Studies. Kat, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for the very warm opening and warm welcome. Just put this on view, okay. So yes, I'd like to just take a moment to more formally thank the QCC administration and particularly Amadis Matos for being here today and being so supportive of all of this programming that we're doing, and the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center, wonderful partners in this program, Dr. Laura Cohen, Victoria Fernandez, and the QCC Art and Design Department, Anne-Marie Coffey, Kenneth Powell, and the chair of our department, Kathleen Wentrek. So I am both a faculty member and also the program coordinator for the Queensborough Community College Gallery Museum Studies program in the Art and Design Department. And I'd just like to share briefly, because this program is so unique, it's one of the really few affordable entry points into the museum field in New York City, because it's the only associate's degree offered within the CUNY system. So our program is affordable, is small, is diverse, and offers a lot of different types of hands-on learning, as well as real-world contact with museum professionals through programs such as this. I'm honored to work with wonderful faculty and students within this program. And you can see some of the work that they're doing and have been doing here. I'm also pleased to be a faculty member in the CUNY School of Professional Studies, Museum Studies MA program. If you have questions about the program at Queensborough, please feel free to reach out to me. So as Laura mentioned, I'd like to just speak a little bit more about our new collaboration. This is just the second program in the Human Rights and the Museum series. And this series builds on the mission of the Kupferberg Holocaust Center, using the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of unbridled prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. And what we are doing with the series is bringing together museum curators, cultural workers, artists to address the roles that historical and cultural institutions can play in addressing human rights, social justice, and genocide. This program and the series itself, I think we can refer to as part of a living land acknowledgement that the Kupferberg Holocaust Center is committed to. This means that Indigenous voices and viewpoints are centered in many of the Human Rights Museum's series programs, including this one. And for those who are a little bit less familiar with the KHC's programming, between 2018 and 2019, the KHC held an 8-program year-long colloquium on Native American cultural survival and resistance. This NEH program then led to the exhibition, and you see the cover of the catalog here. You can access actually the whole catalog, practically the whole much of the exhibition online. And the exhibition, Survivance and Sovereignty on Turtle Island, Engaging with Contemporary Native American Art, was hosted between 2019 and 2020. And what we came to understand is that this is the first exhibition dedicated to the ramifications of genocide on this continent held at any center of this kind in the United States. Both the program, the NEH program, and then also the exhibition were collaboratively curated by Danielle Means and myself, along with curatorial team members, Indigenous knowledge keepers, a diverse group of gallery museum studies students, KHC Community Committee that was made up of a number of second generation Holocaust survivors, and KHC staff members. This collaborative project and the related faculty and student engagement seeded the concrete commitment to Indigenous voices and perspectives, such as this program. For those of you who are interested in hearing and seeing more, you can access through the first link, and I think these are going to be posted in the chat as well, the first program in our series that was held earlier in March, as well as other KHC programs. And there's a second link that allows you to access all the different programming the KHC has done that deals with Native American and Indigenous survivance in particular. Now to turn more specifically to today's event, I just want to provide a little bit of background, and then I'm going to pass on the program to Taylor Payer. So she'll be addressing contributions that she's made to various different institutions, including her current work at the Hood Museum of Art, which, like the Kupferberg, is also on a college campus set on Dartmouth College. And over the last couple of years, Dartmouth College and the Hood have taken steps towards indigenizing as an institution. And we have one example here on the slide on the screen here on the left. In 2018, the Hood appointed the first associate curator of Native American art, Jamie Powell. She's curated numerous powerful exhibitions, including we see one image here from an exhibition. And there, the front of the exhibition itself, the front of the museum itself, is transformed by a work by Chinupahanska Luger, an artist who came to speak at the Kupferberg as well as part of our programming in 2019. This work is titled Every One. It's made up of over 4,000 ceramic beads, symbolizing the number of the cases of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Canada in 2016. Together, the beads, made by many different hands, rehumanize this data, this number 4,000, and form the face of one of these women who was pictured first in a photograph titled Sister by collaborating artist Kylie Spitzer. Here we see just one example of how an institution can be transformed, the face of the institution itself re-indigenized. Four, most simply, indigenize means to bring under the control or influence of people who are native to a region. The word can also relate somewhat to a more popular concept today of decolonization, which can involve turning over or sharing authority in addressing Native art and culture within an institutional context. This process is necessary based on the fact that many of our institutions are founded on land, all of our institutions are founded on land, and some also on collections and exhibition practices that are marked by colonization, and which can serve to replicate dehumanizing narratives related to Native peoples and even to continue erasure. While the de and decolonize may feel like an impossibility, or an attempt to disappear an uncomfortable history with many present day ramifications, the term indigenize or even re-indigenize shifts the focus and offers an opportunity to center Indigenous experience and perspectives more directly. With that, I'm very pleased to introduce Taylor Payer. I'll share a bit about Taylor's accomplishments, and I know she'll speak more about her work herself. Taylor is a member of the Turtle Mountain Band of Chippewa, and she assists with developing relationships between the Hood Museum of Art, Dartmouth College Library, and Native American and Indigenous communities built around, and her work is built around collaboration and collections-based research. She earned her MA in Public Humanities from Brown University and a BA in Women and Gender Studies from Dartmouth College. While an undergrad, Taylor interned at the Hood, where she developed this interest in collections, art, and museum education. Since then, Taylor has had various curatorial research and education roles at the Rhode Island School of Design Museum of Art, the Walker Art Center, the Portland Art Museum, Socrates Sculpture Park, All My Relations Art Gallery. Taylor was also a 2020 Art Table Fellowship recipient. Taylor, we are very honored and pleased to have you here to speak with us. And I will go ahead and turn over the program to you.
Thank you so much, Kat. Thank you to everyone for having me. I'm going to share my slides in just a second here. But I did just want to, again, thanks for having me and sort of greet you in a good way. Buju, Anin, Taylor Rose, Payer, Indigenakaz. So my name is Taylor and I'm an enrolled member of the Trail Mountain Band of Chippewa. And I currently reside on the lands and the homelands and territory of the Abenaki people in what is now called Hanover in Lebanon, New Hampshire. So I'm actually going to start there. Let's talk a little bit about this sort of land acknowledgement thing. And from there, I want to share more with you about who I am, how I came to be the person in front of you that is telling you about indigenizing institutions and why I should know anything about that at all. And then from there, I'll share some of my work with you, some of my ideas about how we can indigenize institutions together as a field, and then we'll go into that Q&A. So just a second while I share my screen. So first of all, I just wanna start by saying, I'm really thankful that the organizers and your sort of institutions think about land acknowledgements and have opened up this talk and this discussion with what is one of the best land acknowledgements I've ever heard. And the reason I say that is because, you know, I'm going to start out sort of bold and say that land acknowledgements too often are what Eve Tuck and Wang call a moves to settler innocence, right? these sort of hollow metaphors that acknowledge the land, but not the people, or acknowledge the land, but not the violence and the history and the atrocities. And so I want to say, Chimagwech, thank you for starting us in that good way. And then as I sort of shared with you, I am on Abenaki land, and I want to start by sort of positing what I think we can do to be a bit better about land acknowledgements. These ideas don't necessarily come from me, but they do come from working for a lot of institutions who struggle to sort of do this work. And I have found throughout my experiences that land acknowledgements, they are something, but they are just the start, right? That is one step to sort of doing this indigenizing type of work. And so I'll model for you right now what I think we should do, which comes from Hayden King, a scholar in Canada who's Anishinaabe and is at Ryerson University. And so he spent a long time making his land acknowledgement for his university. And then he sort of comes out later in an interview and says, I regret doing that because it's an empty sort of thing. We're not actually giving land back. We're not doing these other things. And what he recommended instead is that when we do these land acknowledgements, we say, I live and work on the territory of the Abenaki, and here's what that compels me to do. And so for me in particular, living and working on this territory compels me to learn the history, the culture, and the presence of Abenaki people. And it compels me to want to continue building relationships with Abenaki artists, youth, students, and other Abenaki thinkers. So I encourage you all going forward, and we can talk about this in the Q&A, to sort of make any land acknowledgement you do, whether it's an event or to your family or anything, try to have an action step with it. Okay, so from there, I'm gonna back way up and tell you about who I am. And I do that for a few reasons. First, you know, I don't want to assume what anyone knows about, you know, Native American communities. There's a lot of misinformation out there, and there can be this idea in the museum and gallery field that one Native person is sufficient and can sort of tell you everything there is to know about something like indigenizing institutions. And I'm here to say that I know very little. Right? I know my slice of my experience and what I've done. I'm still an emerging professional. So as I say, today should really just be a discussion, as I am certainly not an expert. And I want to tell you about who I am and where I'm from. So you can see that, for example, you all are based in Queens, New York. Those are not sort of indigenous communities or other communities that I know about. That's not an experience that I've had personally. And I think once you understand and can see my positionality and where I come from in my family, you'll see how I got to these sort of opinions and questions and educating around indigenizing institutions. So let me sort of start in an indigenous way, the way that I was taught to start. So as Kat said, and as I've said, I'm an enrolled member of the Turtle Mountain Band of Chippewa. That already requires a little bit of explanation. That is the name of my tribe as the federal government in the United States sees it. But we refer to ourselves as Anishinaabe. And in Anishinaabe life and worldview, we sort of organize our values under seven main teachings. These seven main teachings are things like humility, respect, and together, they really add up to the good life, or as we call it, Mino Bima Diziwin. And so this photo is my family and I, three of my four siblings. I'm all the way to the right, wearing a Pocahontas shirt, which is something we can have a critical conversation about. And this is just to show you who I am, where I come from, and the diversity, even within my own family, as far as appearance goes. Okay, and let me back up and tell you. So I said that I'm Anishinaabe. The misnomer for that is Chippewa. That was a name given to us from settlers. So you can see that this is a really large community, right? And this map sort of points to how I, by family, ended up way, way tippy-top northern part of North Dakota, despite our traditional homelands being around the Great Lakes region. Okay, this map is sort of difficult to look at, but I just want to give you a sense of just how much land my people called home for thousands of years, right? So a long time ago, 100 years ago, 150 years ago, we sort of had, you know, the pink area around the Red River Valley. We had that bluish purplish area. All of that was ours and what we lived off of. Throughout various treaties, which were sort of manipulative and took advantage of my people, we have been dwindled down to that bright green little box that you see on your screen, making us one of the smallest reservations in the country at 6 by 12 miles. And it has been that way for quite a few years now. Yeah, and here's a photo of where I'm from, just again, trying to paint a picture about who I am and how I came to be sitting before you. You know, we're from a community that really honors our sort of wetlands, and we're called the Turtle Mountains in a funny way because that really refers to hills, not mountains. But when you're way out there in North Dakota, the land is very, very flat right up until you get to our reservation, and then we have hills and water, and it's a very beautiful area that I'm lucky to have been born and raised in. Yeah, so before I move on, you know, why do I start here? And as vulnerable as it is, I don't usually share that personal part of my life when making professional talks. It's important to know because, you know, I was talking to my dad last night, and he says, you have to let people know that even though you have a certain amount of privilege with the way that you can be sort of white-coated or by other people and all the privileges that come with that, it's important to note that I grew up in a reservation context, right? I grew up in a modern day sort of Native community, and that really informs the way that I approach my life, my values, and my work. Okay, so let me tell you about some of my work and start sort of illustrating for you my ideas about indigenizing institutions. So as I maybe sort of alluded to, I grew up kind of in the middle of nowhere, and I was rich in terms of culture and family and a belief in education and working hard. But I was working class in a lot of ways as well, and I didn't necessarily have access to museums or other things like it. And so that I've ended up being sort of a museum professional is quite funny to me and most of my family. I always thought I'd be a lawyer or a school teacher or something like that. But, you know, as it goes, I went to college at Dartmouth, and I was a big activist sort of person and was really looking for ways to talk about Indigenous feminisms and queer studies and things like that, and even protesting in the Occupy movement. And I kind of quickly discovered that, in fact, contemporary art was a way to have those conversations. You know, artists like Rebecca Belmore, who you see in front of you, and Kara Walker and Carrie Mae Weems could say more in a single piece of artwork than I could say with one of my 30-page papers, right? Or a protest around campus. And so I got started by working at the museum while in college because I needed the money, to be honest. But I sort of fell in love with contemporary art and the provocations that it had around feminisms and Native history. So this was a shot from the first thing that I ever curated, which was this little show featuring Belmore and some other artists. Yeah, and so I start here after college. I kind of devoted myself full time to this little Native art world. And I want to start here just to tell you that I've had, in my short time as a professional, so many different jobs. It's quite funny. So my first one was at a very small gallery. I would call it a community nonprofits gallery in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And this was not the sort of institution that you had to indigenize. And in fact, it was and remains one of the only art spaces in the country that is curated by Native folks. The board is Native folks. The staff is all Native, and it features only contemporary Native artists. And so it's very Indigenous centric in that way. So there wasn't a lot of indigenizing that had to be done because the people brought it day in and day out. We can talk more about the work that I did there, but again, very small, very DIY type of space. Above, you see a photo of the Walker, which is a rather big institution that I also worked at in Minneapolis, where I was an educator. And going between those two institutions was quite funny, going from the one that was all Native people situated in the heart of the Native community in Minneapolis to just up the street where it was sort of that white cube, mostly white art world, and trying to use it as an opportunity to educate people about Native art. And then below is myself when I was quite young and a frequent collaborator of mine, Maggie Thompson of Mukwa Studio. And I show you that picture to show you that my curatorial practice has always been a collaborative one. I don't do much of anything alone. I believe in sort of a multiplicity, cacophony of voices. And she's a great friend of mine who helps me think in ways that I wouldn't be able to on my own, especially given that she's an artist and a curator. And I encourage you to look up her work, Mukwa Studios. Great. So this is a show that Maggie and I did together. And something that I hope you all can take away during this talk is one's curatorial practice or any sort of art and culture-based practice can and should be place-based. And what I mean by that is when you're working with Indigenous art or Indigenous people, we are a people that very much value our homelands, right? And so that sort of lends itself to place-based work being super powerful. So this exhibit was sort of challenging the racist colonial art that was featured at our state capitol in St. Paul, Minnesota. And I don't know how well you can see it, but these types of paintings decorate the entire rotunda, and school children of Minnesota saw these things in a sort of unmitigated way all of the time. So what did we do about it? We curated in our small Native art galleries, two of them, a show of contemporary Native artists and other artists of color who wanted to, or we encouraged to talk back against the single stories that were being represented in that racist art in the Capitol. So we had about 16 artists sort of make provocative new pieces speaking out against it. Another component was inviting the public to leave their note cards for their ideas of art that could replace those very racist images. And I'm happy to report that this project in 2016 resulted in the State Capitol Commission actually taking these note cards and implementing some of those changes, which was wonderful. And just last summer, we must have been sort of early takers on this public art thing in Minnesota, because just last summer we got to witness a group of people pull down the Christopher Columbus statue at the Capitol as well. And several sort of Minnesota leaders supported that protest action. So things are definitely changing. Great. Next, I want to talk about my educator practice and some ways of sort of indigenizing within that focus beyond the curatorial work. So this is a still shot from the Walker Art Center. This is an essay that I wrote. And then to the right of that is just the shot of me leading some tours with college students at the Hood Museum of Art. And that's a Jean Quick-to-See Smith painting to your right. So to go back to the Walker project, I think there are quite a few lessons in here that we can all take with us, I hope, when it comes to indigenizing. So the Walker Art Center, you may or may not know, it's unfortunately been sort of infamous in the art world as of late for some scandals. So they featured an artist, Jimmy Durham, whose Cherokee heritage has been said to be, you know, either like not real or something like that. And maybe that was not the person that should have that exhibition at the Walker. And relatedly, there was the scaffold sort of incident, which was when an artist was commissioned to make a gallows piece in the public sculpture garden that was very offensive to the local Dakota people in Minneapolis. So, you know, that's what we're sort of dealing with at the Walker. And indigenizing a place like that is not easy, but it's important, and there are ways to do it. So what you see in front of you is a commission of the Ojibwe artist Frank Big Bear, who did this huge sort of mural. And the project was that local Native youth from the Little Earth housing community were paid to come in and be docents for this piece and engage, you know, visitors from all over Minneapolis, all over the state, in this Native work. And it was one of the proudest moments of my early career, just seeing like Native youth who went from never being in a museum to actually getting compensated to engage with this Native work. Great. So a bit of a harsh transition, but when we're talking about indigenizing institutions, you can't leave the repatriation conversation out of it. And I want to briefly go over some work I've done, and then again, we can talk more in the Q&A more broadly about these issues. A couple summers ago now, during graduate school, I took a summer internship at the Portland Art Museum in Oregon. And I originally went to work with my mentor, Kathleen Ash Milby, who's a Diné curator, scholar, and was at the Smithsonian for a very long time. I originally went to work with her and work on an exhibition of the Native Lakota modernist Oscar Howe. But, you know, she was new to the job and sort of quickly discovered that the museum was not compliant with the NAGPRA law, which makes repatriation a sort of mandate to happen. And despite not having done the work before, we quickly transitioned my internship to doing the research and the relationship building that we needed to in order to return about 20 sacred objects that were stolen from the community many, many years prior. And the community in question is the Wrangell tribe of the Tlingit in what is now called southeastern Alaska. So what you see on the left are just a few of the objects that were claimed by the Tlingit. And many of them were on display sort of permanently. I mean, they're very, very beautiful objects. What you see on the right is the result of my internship and my mentor, Kathleen, doing a lot of work to really push these repatriations ahead. And I'm happy to report that that has happened. Couple notes before I move on. You know, repatriation work is really important. It's not the only indigenizing step, but it's difficult to ask a tribe or an indigenous community to partner with you on something at a museum or at a gallery if you are working for a place that still has not returned either human remains, meaning ancestors, or sacred objects. Again, similar to the land acknowledgement, it's sort of one of those first steps, at least that's my belief. And so if you ever find yourself working at a place that still has outlying repatriation issues, do what you can to try to push it along, make it happen. I saw a joke earlier that NAGPRA, don't forget the NAG part of NAGPRA, meaning as professionals, no matter what your position, we should nag our institutions to do this work until it happens, however long it takes. Okay, why does repatriation work matter? I mean, this picture says it all, right? This is a community that celebrates every year, has one of the largest sort of Native arts and culture celebrations in the continent. And until they can get their sacred objects back and the other material that is rightfully theirs, they can't do their proper dances, their songs, their ceremonies. They are incomplete without these things that they consider to be their ancestors, their relatives. This is a contemporary picture of that celebration, but you can see how these things really have so much more life when they're with their communities of origin, so much more life than can be had when they're in a museum shelf. Okay, and I'm going to finish up here. As Kat mentioned during my intro, a more recent experience that I had and one that I'm very proud of is an art table fellowship and a placement at the Socrates Sculpture Park, which I did last summer in Queens. Right, and so this was a great opportunity. I'm saddened to say it was a short opportunity. You know, it was only 2 months. It was a summer thing, sort of post my graduate program, but it was amazing to be in Queens, even during the pandemic. It was amazing to be around these artists who are so creative and to get to work with people at Art Table and Socrates that are so supportive of women in the field and are increasingly supportive of Indigenous people in the field. The thing I want to get across here is that no matter what type of work I'm doing, I always want to be centering Indigenous artists, right? And so you can't do anything, whether it's getting a board together, repatriating, advertising something, it doesn't matter. We should be centering artists in that work because they're creative, you know, they have a different way of looking at the world, and we should be sort of empowering them. And so my time at Socrates sort of enabled me to do that. What you see here is the musician Laura Ortman, who's White Mountain Apache, and she is performing with her violin on top of Jeffrey Gibson's, you know, very large sculpture, which some of you may have gotten to see. And I was able to interview Laura and sort of promote her work and her voice that way through a written piece that you can look up on Socrates' website. Right, another important part of that Art Table Fellowship, but also just my career, and also for you all when it comes to Indigenizing institutions, it's building those relationships. That's really what's at the heart of this work. And so these are just a few of the folks that I got to work with while at the Socrates Sculpture Park. And yeah, you can ask me about that in the Q&A as well. Finally, I didn't want to leave historic Indigenous-made objects out of the conversation. I mean, artists today are so, so important to this work. But the artists whose names that we don't know, whose work ended up in so many of our institutions, they are also really, really important. Right? We might not know their names, but with research, with relationships, we can know the communities they came from. We could do that interpretive work. And so here's a couple examples. On the left, this is me at my current job consulting with Sea Alaska Heritage Institute in Alaska, asking them what that particular object on the table means to them, right? If our museum catalog calls it, you know, a button robe. Well, what do you guys call it? What does the Indigenous community call it? And what does it mean to you? And then really forefronting their expertise in the way that we display and teach with this art. On the right is a bandolier bag, which I wrote an essay about for the RISD Museum, which is another place I used to work. And my point here is just like, these aren't just objects, right? They have lives, they have ongoing sort of importance to Indigenous people. And that's another way to come at this work. If you can't necessarily work with an artist, but you have an opportunity to work with an object, try to build those relationships around these pieces of art as well. Okay. So a couple things to get us started with our discussion portion of today. I'm sure most people maybe heard the term decolonizing museums, and maybe you've even heard of this book and the scholar, Dr. Amy Lone Tree, who is Ho-Chunk and is sort of really well known for this question of decolonizing museums as it pertains to Indigenous people. I'm just going to read this quote out loud because I think it's really important as we go into the Q&A. A decolonizing museum practice must involve assisting tribal communities in addressing the legacies of unresolved grief. I think this is an important one because as happy as a lot of this work makes me, it's important to note that when we're dealing with Indigenizing institutions, when we're dealing with museums, we're talking about places of tremendous pain for people. We're talking about legacies of violence and display of Indigenous ancestors. And we got to sort of approach this contemporary work with those things in mind. And of course, this is my reminder, there is no decolonizing museums without centering Indigenous voices and knowledges. Like, that is the work. That's the most important thing. Finally, just before we start that Q&A, I wanted to offer up some of my practical ideas for how we can do this work. Again, I don't want it to be like, you know, Indigenization is just a metaphor or a move to settler innocence. I want to actually offer some tangibles here. So how can we do this work? Here's a few of my ideas. I also want to hear yours. People. There's no Indigenizing institutions without bringing Native people to the table, right? The staff, the leadership, boards, they should have Native members. We need to bring Indigenous artists to the forefront, and Native youth must have some power and some voice in this work. Research and reciprocity, these go hand in hand. You need to know as much as you can about a particular object or artist or tribal community and be really specific in your language, right? Things like you can say Indigenous, you can say Native, but actually it's best to try to know that person's tribal nation and identify them that way, right? So I'm Taylor, I'm Anishinaabe. You could say she's an Anishinaabe curator, for example. Interpretation, land acknowledgement, really important good stuff. Finally, Indigenous art. There's a debate about whether or not Indigenous art is art or something else. I believe and like to say it's art and it's all these other things, right? It's also social, political, it's spiritual for Native people. And again, getting back to that reciprocity, you have to pay people, you have to build your budgets with Indigenous values in mind, and you have to be willing to be in constant exchange and relationship as you're doing this work. Here's a list of people that I think alongside and some resources for you all. Again, I should just say that they all know way more than I do, and all of their work is worth visiting and thinking about. And these are people who've really sort of taught me and the reason I have the opinions I do today. All right. Thank you for listening to me, and thank you for this conversation. As we start to do the Q&A, I just wanted to leave you with this quote from Leanne Simpson, who's another Indigenous thinker that I look up to a lot.
Taylor, thank you so much. Thank you so warmly for this really broad and beautiful and very generous presentation. Thank you. So I'll start or transition with that. The Q&A is open. I see one comment, and I just want to remind folks that please do feel free to post your comment, your questions in the Q&A. So that not the chat has some links, but the Q&A is where you can participate by adding questions. I have students in courses at CUNY in various campuses and various classes who are studying and writing about repatriation and writing about some of the topics that we covered today. So I really hope they will put in some questions for us. And of course, all the other community members who are here who've been engaging in this program and other programs. Maybe I'll start out with one question, which is hard. I have a map of questions written out because there's so many fantastic topics that we could discuss and so many things that I felt connected to in what you were saying. So I appreciate that. But I think maybe the one that feel the one of your comments that felt the like it really connected to the Kupferberg Holocaust Center and some of the work that the folks around the center have been doing has is this question around addressing grief and historical trauma. So certainly that was really in mind when we were working on the Survivance exhibition, because Daniel Means and I were kept thinking, how do we connect and what would it look like when we connect the survivor communities, first generation and second generation Holocaust survivors who gather at the center? They came pre-COVID for bagels and brunch regularly, a really, really special community. So the Kupferberg Holocaust Center had been doing this work for a long time of addressing grief and historical trauma and having a place for that. But what would it mean to bring together Indigenous survivors and Holocaust survivors? And what does that look like? So when you bring that up, Taylor, what kinds of concrete things do you think of or do you think are possible within the institutional context or educational context?
Yeah, I mean, a couple of things. That's a really great question. I'll start by saying, you know, I mentioned it earlier, but questions like that, it's exactly what I mean to be place-based. It's about finding who's around you and really building those relationships thoughtfully and then allowing, you know, those sorts of events and connections to come out of the relationships. So it's almost like you build the relationship first and then a lot of these other things come with that. And it requires a lot of patience, but some tangibles are, again, building into your budget things like giving gifts to Indigenous people. Not all of us, but many of us come from those gift-giving cultures where if you're going to ask an Indigenous elder, can you come give a blessing at this event? You want to go to them with tobacco or with something, a token of your appreciation, really getting started in that good way. And then second, I know it's not COVID friendly, but anytime you can do a food thing, that's really Indigenous for us. And you'd be surprised at the amount of knowledge that is shared when it is a dinner, when it is a breakfast, when it's a feast, when it's a meal. And just another tip, as we are in COVID times, I am engaging people around sending Indigenous food gifts to them instead of having a meal. So if you find Indigenous food vendors online, and there's many of them, that's another great way to have a virtual visit and send that maple syrup, that wild rice, that smoked salmon before time.
Yeah, that was very accurate to our experience at the center. Food was one of the first discussions when we thought about planning for opening celebrations, and that it was food made by local folks. And it was in that context that we saw really powerful connections being made, and that, you know, we're here today because of those first connections. I'm starting to see questions come into the chat. So let's start with one from Ellen, who writes, how would you like to see students involved in this work? Are there any opportunities that you would recommend to them?
Yeah, definitely. First, before I say anything else, with the art table fellowship opportunity that I mentioned, that is the one that I would recommend to all students to look into, if not for this year, for future years. It's a paid opportunity, which is still too rare for student internships and summer opportunities. And it also, you know, no matter what you do for that art table fellowship, you get an exposure to this network of people who, you know, they might not all be Indigenous, but I found it to be one of the greatest groups of people who want to do this work, right? And that is so encouraging because, as I keep saying, this work is really hard. And when you're Indigenous or when you're an oppressed person, it means everything to be part of a network that does want to encourage you, even as you're dealing with, you know, racial injustices or enduring colonization, or, you know, in so many of our cases with the pandemic, you know, really disproportionately hurting our Native communities and our communities of color. it helps to be part of a professional network that understands and supports you. So that's first, do art table. Second, it's never too early for students to get involved in this work. I mean, if you are doing something at your institution already and notice like, oh, we don't have an Indigenous speaker, or we are ignoring that object, or I wonder if there's repatriation work we should do, then say something. Say something, you know, raise a little hell about it, because we need you. And then, you know, working on things like repatriation as students is really, really important research as well. It's difficult work, but it's rewarding. So try to look for those opportunities.
Thank you so much, Taylor. I'll share that and just close that I'm a board member of Art Table and the fellowship. So for those who are less familiar, Art Table is a women's leadership organization, and they have a fellowship which now offers 15 different slots at different institutions. So you apply and you know already what institution you might go to, what project you might work on. And it is a diversity fellowship. So we're mid-process this year, but the application comes out every March and it seems to grow every year. So we are happy to have more and more slots every year. I'm just pleased to hear that your experience was so positive in particular with that, with Art Table. I'll also say that the Kupferberg Holocaust Center offers fellowships that or internships that Dr. Laura Cohen and Victoria and Marissa Hollywood have been worked really hard to build into equitable, compensated, thoughtful experiences. And we have one currently, for example, where a student from SPS that I'm working with, the School of Professional Studies, is working on turning the Survivance exhibition into a really accessible LibGuide. And we'll be excited to launch that next year. So I think now, thinking more broadly about institutions, I'm going to combine a question of mine and a comment with a student's question. Christine Beattie asked, I thought, Taylor, earlier a lot about what you were saying in terms of being an activist and looking for a place for that work, and being a feminist and looking for a place for that work, and it being in the museum, because I also studied women and gender studies undergraduate. I also did a lot of activist work undergraduate, and I do think of a museum as a place for that. But we're at a moment where I think that not everybody sees that. We're very critical of our institutions, rightfully so also. So I'm just kind of interested to your thinking about, you know, this balance of like the radical possibility of the museum. But on the other hand, what I think Christine is asking, how do we hold institutions accountable for the actions of indigenization if we're not working within them?
Yeah, there's a lot of good things in there. Although I'll try to keep it a bit brief. You know, let me start this way, because let me try to practice what I preach about centering Indigenous voices, right? So there's this Tlingit elder scholar that I work with, and you should look her up if you'd like. Her name is Dr. Rosita Worrell. And she started a meeting I was in by saying to me and to all of us, you know, I am pissed as hell that museums took all of our things, but boy, am I sure glad that they took care of them. And that stuck with me a lot. And I heard it and I kind of think to myself, you know, when I'm having doubts about the work that I do, it's going back to Rosita's words and thinking about, yes, the history of museums and Indigenous people, as well as other communities, it's not great. And we need to hold institutions accountable for that history. Mm-hmm. At the same time, there is all of this sort of potential and beauty and opportunity within museums. I won't speak to some of those other examples because I don't know them intimately, but for Indigenous people, you know, imagine in my case being from a tiny little reservation that doesn't necessarily have an art museum or any sort of access to one, and then going off to college and being able to see and experience tremendous, powerful artists like the Anishinaabe artists, Rebecca Belmore. You know, it means everything to us as Native people to work with art where, you know, one piece of art can teach you your culture, your history, your spirituality. And I guess what I'm trying to say is that's a tremendous responsibility as museum and gallery professionals, that we get to be stewards of that work and these artists and those histories. And we got to be able to walk and chew gum at the same time, right? Repatriation has to happen. Decolonizing has to happen. And there are certain things that only a public museum or other sort of public venue can offer, right? This isn't privatized like so many other things. And that's worth noticing and organizing around for our Native communities and our other folks who want to learn from these institutions.
I think we have time for one more question before I pass the program to Laura to close. So F.A., who's a student in Gallery Museum Studies at Queensborough, asked, can you talk a little bit about your first museum job after graduating and what you learned there? What is that? First position.
Yeah, so I believe you're referring to the All My Relations Arts Gallery, which is not a museum, but like a very tiny community-based arts organization and community development organization. And so although it was small and sort of local, it also was very formative for me as a professional, because like I said, I was around Native people all the time. Native thinkers, Native administrators, the Native elders that hung out in our coffee shop that was connected to the gallery. And I got to meet a lot of artists this way too, because although it's sort of a small space that doesn't have the visitation numbers that museums do, you know, almost every contemporary Native artist in the area did something with us because it was a space that really showcased Native art in particular. And so I came on as a gallery assistant, where I literally counted the number of visitors who came through. And I sort of worked my way up to assistant curator, where I put on 3 exhibitions a year. Some of those exhibitions were out in the streets, right? Some of those exhibitions were performances, dances, community development things, like I said. And like I said, you know, the values that I learned there were about like intergenerational knowledge and community learning, having food at events, budgets, you know, and again, working with artists from the get-go. You know, it's not enough to just acquire their art, but like contact them, think alongside them from the beginning.
Thank you so much. So I think I'm gonna, that is the last question. This has gone by so quickly, but it's been a wonderful conversation. So thank you very much, Taylor. And I'll pass the program back to Laura to close for us.
Thank you, Taylor. I've been sitting just kind of reflecting on all the themes that you raised. And I can honestly say, like, I've learned a lot. You've really pushed my understanding as well. This is a process and conversations Kat and I have had a lot of. And it's really humbling to do this work. It's hard to do this work. And I really want to just say thank you for challenging us to do more and to do better. I was in a conversation, it was in a conference this weekend about reparations. And it was also very humbling and uncomfortable. And it's okay for it to be able to sit with that discomfort. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you to Kat for organizing this. We're really grateful to be hosting this Human Rights in the Museum series. It's very important for our center. I wanna thank everyone in the community who's joined, all the students. I wanna thank Victoria Fernandez, our administrative coordinator, and Amadeus Matos. You can find more information about the Kupferberg Holocaust Center on our website, which Victoria shared in the chat. We hope you all stay safe and well. Thank you so much.